Hi everyone, my name is Theo. I'm a PhD student in the Julia Lab at MIT, and today I'm talking to you about Chordal.jl, which is a package for dealing with Chordal sparse matrices, largely motivated by the application of sparse semidefinite programming. And I'll define all these terms in just a moment. First, a semidefinite program, or SDP, is an optimization problem with positive semidefinite matrix constraints. So we have some optimization variable, Z, which is a symmetric matrix, and we want to maximize a linear function of that matrix subject to linear equality constraints and a positive semidefinite matrix constraint. And so these optimization problems come up all over the place. SDPs can be found everywhere from statistics and machine learning to combinatorial optimization to circuit design and mechanical truss design. They turn out to be enormously useful modeling tools. So odds are, whatever field you're in, there's some set of problems that can be modeled as SDPs. Unfortunately, though, these things aren't used that much in practice, largely due to scaling issues. And this is due to the fact that most general purpose solvers have a per iteration cost that's approximately cubic in the side dimension. And so what this means in practice is that for even modest problem sizes, n in the few hundreds, where n is the side dimension, the solve time scales quite dramatically, rendering these entirely impractical for general purpose solvers for very large problems. And what this means is we need to take advantage of some type of additional structure in the SDPs that we want to solve. And so one structural element that we can often exploit is sparsity. Since usually, or in a lot of situations, the objective function and the linear equality constraints are quite sparse, meaning that only a small percentage of the entries of the matrix variable Z, say 2%, actually affect the objective and the equality constraints. And so what that means is that positive semidefinite matrix constraint forces us to care about 50 times the number of variables that we would otherwise. So ideally, what we'd like to do is we'd like to get rid of this dense n by n positive semidefinite matrix constraint. And we want to know if we only look at those 2% of the entries of Z that we care about in the objective and the equality constraints, we want to know if there's some positive semidefinite matrix out there where we don't care about the other 98% of entries. We just care that it matches Z, or it matches Z on the 2% of entries we care about, and the other 98% are whatever they need to be to make the matrix positive semidefinite. In other words, we need some type of tool that gives us a check that a sparse matrix can be completed to be a positive semidefinite matrix. And for this, we're going to turn to some things or some tools from graph theory. So it's useful to think of sparsity patterns as undirected graphs. A sparsity pattern of a matrix is essentially just an indicator of where there are non-zeros and where there are zeros. So for example, the sparsity pattern of the matrix here on the left is shown in the center. And this corresponds to an undirected graph by looking at the off-diagonal entries and everywhere we have a non-zero, drawing an edge between the corresponding vertices of that graph. We call a graph chordal if all cycles of length greater than 3 have a chord. So for example, this graph on the left is chordal because there are no cycles of length greater than 3. However, the graph on the right isn't chordal because it has cycle length 4 and there's no chord in it, a chord being an edge between non-adjacent vertices. However, any graph can be made chordal by adding edges. So on the right, we can add an edge between 2 and 4, and now this graph is going to be chordal. And the reason we care about chordality is many hard graph problems like graph coloring or maximal click are easy in a complexity theory sense on chordal graphs. Finally, one more definition. A click is a set of vertices that induces a maximal complete subgraph, complete meaning that all the vertices in that subgraph are connected to each other. So for example, on the right, there are two clicks now that I've added this edge. One is 1, 2, 4, and the other is 2, 3, 4. So now equipped with these definitions, we can go back to that tool that we wanted for the SDP. And we have a check that Z is positive semidefinite by looking at submatrices. Specifically, if we have a sparse matrix Z with a chordal sparsity pattern, so that means that if we look at the undirected graph that corresponds to that sparsity pattern, it's a chordal graph, that matrix has a positive semidefinite completion if and only if the submatrices indexed by the clicks, or the submatrices that correspond to the clicks, are all positive semidefinite. And this can be applied directly to that semidefinite program we looked at earlier. So here we can take out that PSD constraint and replace it with the PSD constraints of Z constrained to the clicks. And so this might not look like we actually did that much here. However, if the side dimension of the matrix N is say 1,000, 10,000 or greater, and the size of the largest clicks might be 10, 20, 30, something like that, this can quite dramatically decrease our solve time, because we go from something that's like O of N cubed to something that's like the sum of the cubes of the clicks. And one thing I'd like to mention is the pure Julia solver, Cosmo.jl, does implement Chordal decomposition in its solve for SDPs. Really encourage you all to check it out. It's a great solver. The purpose of Chordal.jl is more to have these routines available and usable in the underlying data structures exposed, so that they can be applied to other problems, not just semi-definite programming. However, semi-definite programming is a fantastic fantastic application of Chordal sparsity. And that's really illustrated in the dramatic speed up that we see in this graph. So here's solving a standard version of this SDP, which is maximum variance unfolding, which is a dimensionality reduction technique, and versus the Chordal version. And you can see that even for, you know, N in the low hundreds, the standard solve time can be 175x slower than the Chordal solve time. And the Chordal solve time looks entirely flat across, you know, from N is 50 to N is 250. So Chordal.jl has functionality for this that you can use with your favorite solver. The plots that I produced on the previous slide were done with an interior point solver. And this plugs in really nicely to jump. In addition, though, it has a number of the underlying data structures and subroutines that are useful when you're working with Chordal graphs or Chordal sparse matrices in other applications as well. And to get a survey of this field and some ideas of what else this is useful for, I encourage you to check out this paper by Vandenberg and Anderson, which really goes into Chordal graphs, Chordal graph theory, and where these show up, both in optimization, but also in other fields as well, and has great pointers to the literature. In addition, this package is very much a work in progress. So I really would love recommendations, suggestions, and if you're using any of this, please reach out to me. And finally, here are the references that I mentioned on the previous slide, if you're interested in checking any of those out. Thank you very much for your time.